Well, happy Easter. I just want to take a moment and welcome everybody here. And we're just honored that you chose Church of the Cross to celebrate Easter. And you know, before we get started with the message, I just want to draw your attention to inside the bulletin, there's a card. And what I do is I kind of work in 6 months time spans for creating messages. I'm actually working on the second half of this year. And I love your input and just to hear maybe something that you have on your heart that maybe I haven't thought about. So there's a card. If you could just kind of complete this sentence, I would love to hear a series or a message on, and fill in the blank. You don't have to put your name on it. And at the end of the service, as you're exiting, you could just hand it to one of the ushers or put it in the box as you are exiting the sanctuary. I would really appreciate, love your suggestion. Well, if you heard about the pastor who one Sunday service wanted to drive home the point to his congregation of evil vices that he wanted his congregation to stay away from. So as an illustration, he brought it out a table, and on that table he had four mason jars. In the first mason jar, he filled it up with whiskey. The second mason jar, he lit a cigarette and put the lit cigarette in the jar. The third jar, he put chocolate syrup. The fourth jar, he put some topsoil. And then what he did is he went back and put an earthworm in each one of the jars. So he put an earthworm in the whiskey, put an earthworm in the cigarette smoke, put another earthworm in the mason jar with the chocolate syrup, and then put another earthworm in the topsoil. And then he went on to give his message, and everybody's kind of leaning in, wondering, where's he going with this? So at the end of his message, he goes back in front of the table and walks over and looks at the one worm that was put in the whiskey, and the worm's dead. Goes to the second one that was put in the cigarette smoke, and that worm is dead. The third one has the chocolate syrup, so he pours it out. At the bottom of the jar is a dead worm. Then the fourth jar, the one with the topsoil, he poured it out, and the worm is live and wiggling, and he picks the worm up and goes to the edge of the stage and says, "Congregation, what does this illustration tell you?" And so there's this little old lady named Maxine in the congregation. She's a woman with a real raspy voice from years of smoking and drinking whiskey. And Maxine said, "If you drink whiskey, if you smoke cigarettes, and you eat chocolate, you'll never have worms." So at that point, he lost the service and couldn't regain. But how many could say that maybe you've been in a service where you felt condemned? Or maybe you felt worse when you left than when you came in. Well, here's the good news today. Jesus didn't come to condemn us, but he came to save us. And the message of Easter is that God has a family, and he wants you to be a part of it. He wants you and his family. You may say, well, you know, if you knew my background, if you knew what I've done, or if you know what I'm in the midst of doing, man, you would never say that God wants me to be a part of his family. Well, the message of Easter is that there's no life too far gone that God can't rescue and save. That there's no bondage too strong that he can't break. That there's no sin that he can't forgive. Why? Because every single one of us here this morning, you matter to God. And I just want to start off by reading the Easter story found in Matthew 28, verses 1 through 10. It says, "Early on Sunday morning, as the new day was dawning, Mary Magdalene and the other Mary went out to visit the tomb. Suddenly there was a great earthquake, for an angel of the Lord came down from heaven, rolled aside the stone, and sat on it. His face shone like lightning, and his clothing was as white as snow. The guards shook with fear when they saw him, and they fell into a deep faint. Then the angel spoke to the women. 'Don't be afraid,' he said. 'I know you're looking for Jesus who was crucified. He is here. He is risen from the dead, just as he said he would happen. Come see where his body was lying, and now go quickly and tell his disciples that he is risen from the dead. He's going ahead of you to Galilee. You will see him there. Remember what I have told you.' The women ran quickly from the tomb. They were very frightened, but also filled with great joy. And they rushed to give the disciples the angel's message. And as they went, Jesus met them and greeted them. And they ran to him, grasped his feet, and worshiped him. Then Jesus said to them, 'Don't be afraid. Go tell my brothers to leave for Galilee, and they will see me there.'" Let's just bow our heads and pray right now. Father, we thank you, God, for Calvary. We thank you, God, just for the opportunity to celebrate Easter and what you've accomplished on Calvary. And Father, I pray, Lord, that as we look at the different passages that we're going to study tonight or today, I pray, God, by your Holy Spirit, you would bring it alive in our hearts. And God, I pray, Father, that we would leave here feeling closer to you than when we walked in. I pray, God, that you just give us understanding on the passages that we're looking at. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. And everybody said?
Amen.
Amen. Well, if you continue to read that story, you'll find out that Jesus wound up staying in Jerusalem for 40 days longer. He didn't just come back from the dead and go back to heaven. He actually hung around for the next 40 days, talking to people, preaching to them. At one point, he was actually talking to a group of 500 people and actually had dinner with them. Another time, he hooks up with disciples on the Sea of Galilee and actually cooked fish for them. That's why over just a very short period of time, over just a couple years, half of Jerusalem became Christian. A city of like 250,000, between 125 and 150,000 people became Christian in just a very short period of time. Why? Because so many people had seen the risen Christ. And I realize I kind of like maybe have a warped sense of humor, but can you imagine being one of the soldiers responsible for crucifying Jesus? And you're in a crowded marketplace, man, you're like shoulder people, and you bump into somebody, and you're turned around, and you're face to face with the one you crucified. I mean, talk about an awkward moment. He would either fall at his feet and just cry out for mercy, or had to go home and change his underwear, one of the two, okay? But why is Easter so important? Because it proves that what Jesus Christ was telling people was true. Because he made some really outrageous claims. He said, I'm the Son of God. I'm God in human form. I'm the only way to heaven. I'm the way, the truth, and the life. And today, here at COTC, we're going to start a brand new five-week series called Too Good to Be True. It's a series designed to help people really understand the grace of God. And when you really look at the love of God and you look at the grace of God and you listen to the message of Easter, it's very easy to maybe come to a conclusion, man, that's just too good to be true. But the truth is, it is true. And it's life-changing when we receive it and embrace it in our life. What's sad is, so many people do not understand the grace of God. And that's why they're afraid of God. That's why they keep God at arm's length. That's why they'll do whatever they can to avoid God, because they do not understand the grace of God. But when you understand the grace of God, your anxiety will actually decrease. Your peace of mind will increase. Your stress levels will come down. Your stability will go up. Let me just ask you a question. Who doesn't want that in their life? Okay? So let's just start off with the definition of grace that I found. It says, grace is the free, undeserved goodness, favor, and power of God towards mankind. And today I want to talk about just experiencing the grace of God when we mess up. When we blow it. And we all mess up. Every one of us has something that we look back on and we say, man, I wish that I'd have never done that. If you heard about the guy named Bill who invited his boss over for dinner. And he's trying to impress his boss because he's up for promotion. So his wife agreed to just put on this excellent dinner. They actually clued their little 8-year-old son, Josh, in on just being on his best behavior. So after this amazing dinner that Bill's wife put on for the boss, little Josh wanted to do his part in impressing his dad's boss. So he runs into his bedroom. He grabs a deck of cards. He brings it out and gives it to the boss as a gift. And the boss was really touched and really flattered about this little boy's gesture. And he said, Josh, why did you pick a deck of cards to give me as a gift? He said, well, I wanted to give you these cards because my dad said you're not playing with a full deck. I mean, you all know somebody messed up there, you know. But all of us have a past. All of us have made mistakes. And your past can either become an anchor in your life or it can become a sail in your life, and grace will make the difference. None of us are batting 1,000. You know, I stopped being perfect about the third breath in after I was born, maybe even sooner than that. I don't measure up to God's standards, let alone my standards. And guess what? You're in the same position I am. We all make mistakes. We all mess up. We've all sinned. Romans 3:23 says, all have sinned. 1 John 1:8 says, if we claim we have not sinned, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. Then Ecclesiastes 7:20 says, not a single person on earth is always good and never sins. In other words, nobody gets it right all the time. We've all messed up. James 3:2 says, we all stumble in many ways. I think we all can agree on it. All of us have stumbled on our words. How many of you ever had something roll off your tongue and, man, you know before it's out, it's rolling off your tongue, it's like, oh man, it was a bad choice of words. And you're hoping you could bring it back. We've all done that, where we've hurt people with our words. Many of us have stumbled with our attitudes, with our actions, with our emotion. How many of us maybe had a wrong emotional response to a close friend or to a spouse, and it just kind of put you at odds with that person? We've all stumbled in many ways. We've all messed up in many ways. The question is, how does God respond when you and I mess up? Well, the answer is he extends grace and mercy to us. And I want us to look at a story found in John 8 that really illustrates this truth. We'll kind of paraphrase it for you. One day, Jesus is talking to this large group of people in front of the temple, and some Pharisees brought to him this woman that was caught up in adultery. Now, if you don't know what a Pharisee is a religious scholar of the time, and they were very judgmental, they were hypocritical, they looked down on people, and everybody hated them. And they were self-righteous, they hated Jesus. But I want to tell you this, common people love Jesus. But it was the religious people that hated Jesus. And the Pharisees hated Jesus and are trying to trap him. So Jesus is teaching this large crowd, and the Pharisees bring this woman caught in adultery. And verse 4 and 5 says this, "Teacher," they said to Jesus, "this woman was caught in the act of adultery. The law of Moses says to stone her. What do you say?" And they're trying to trap Jesus into saying something that they can use against him. And before we read the rest of the story, I just want to notice a couple things here. There's two traps being laid here. First, the embarrassed woman is caught in a wrong relationship. And then the second thing that's happening is they're trying to catch Jesus and trying to corner him with a wrong response. And let me ask you a question. What do you get caught up in? What do you get caught up in that trips you up? Maybe it's an unhealthy relationship. Maybe it's a secret habit or a secret sin. Maybe you're caught up in materialism where you're living your life thinking, man, you know, it's just all about more money and more toys, and whoever dies with the most toys wins. Maybe it's an addiction. Maybe it's the approval of others. Many people in our culture is living for the approval of others, and that's a trap. This woman is obviously caught in a wrong relationship. And here's what happened in verse 6. It says this. They were trying to trap Jesus into saying something they could use against him. But Jesus stooped down and started writing in the dirt with his finger. I love it. He's doodling in the dirt. He's writing in the dirt with his finger. He won't even dignify these accusations against this woman. So they're badgering Jesus. They're pressing him to respond to their question. So finally, Jesus stands up and says, okay, I'll answer you. Whoever, any of you guys who've never sinned, you can go ahead and cast the first stone. And then he stooped back down and started writing in the dirt. I love this scene. Nobody actually knows what Jesus wrote in the dirt, but many scholars believe, and I agree, I tend to agree with them, that he was possibly writing the secret sins of these guys, of these accusers, in the sand. He's God. He knows everything. He could read their mail. So he could very well could have been writing their secret sins in the sand. And Jesus is going right to the heart of the matter. And one thing I want you to notice here, that in this public situation, Jesus protects this woman's dignity. Has she made a mistake? Absolutely. Man, she's cheated on her husband. She committed adultery, and that's not right. But Jesus protects her dignity in front of these hypocritical accusers. And later on, in privacy, on a one-on-one situation, he's going to deal with their sin, deal with her sin in a very sensitive fashion. We're going to go down a trail here for just a moment, but I want to say this. If you call yourself a Christian, if you claim to be a follower of Jesus Christ, you must treat every single person with dignity. We particularly need to be reminded of this in a political and social climate that we're living in today. It doesn't matter who they are. It doesn't matter if they have a different religion, a different lifestyle, a different political persuasion. They may be involved in all kinds of gross and evil stuff. You still have to treat them with dignity, because that's what Jesus would do. Jesus accepted everybody. He didn't approve of everything they did, but he accepted everybody. Jesus accepts me. Jesus doesn't approve of everything I do, but he accepts me. He accepts you. He doesn't approve of everything that you do, but he treats you with dignity and treated the woman with dignity. So he says to these guys, okay, any of you guys who haven't sinned, go ahead and cast the first stone. In verse 9, it says this, when the accusers, by the way, regardless of what you've done in your lifetime, if you come to COTC, I want to let you know you will be treated with dignity here. You are welcomed here. Verse 9 says this, when the accusers heard this, they began to slip away one by one, beginning with the oldest, until only Jesus was left in the middle of the crowd with a woman. So all the accusers, they leave. And here's what's interesting to me. The ones that started to leave the first was the oldest. I think that's just kind of interesting. That just kind of jumps out at me. Why is that? I'm just going to give you my 2 cents worth. I really believe that hopefully as we get older, we're getting wiser. And maybe we're beginning to connect the dots that, hey, we don't have it all together. There's areas that we're messed up in, and there's areas that we still need work in. And the older I get, the more I realize what I don't know. You follow what I'm saying? Of how much I do need a Savior. And I'm in no way trying to talk down to the younger generation. I'm reflecting back when I was younger. We tend to be idealistic. We tend to think we have it all together when we don't really have it all together. And I really believe, man, these older guys, they're walking away saying, man, Jesus played us, man. He's got us. Okay? And they're walking away. They're understanding what's happening here. So now everybody's gone. Jesus is one-on-one in a situation with this lady. So what's he going to do? Well, verse 10 and 11 says, then Jesus stood up again and said to the woman, where are your accusers? Didn't even one of them condemn you? No, Lord, she said. And Jesus said, neither do I. Go and sin no more. Another translation puts it this way. Now go on and leave your sinful way. Jesus is basically saying to her, man, you're better than this. You know better than this. That's all he's going to say. Notice he doesn't whip out this 10-point sermon on adultery. He just says, you know what? I don't condemn you. You're better than this. Go now. Don't do this. This is stupid. Just go. Don't do this again. I love this. I love this because this is how Jesus handles our failures when we come to him when we mess up. He didn't condemn her. He didn't condone her. He didn't say, oh, it's okay, no problem. No, it was serious, man. She committed adultery. She betrayed her husband. But he didn't condemn her. He didn't condone her. He changed her. And that's what it's all about. And that's what he does in your life when you accept his grace and mercy. He doesn't condemn you. He doesn't condone you. He doesn't condone what you do. He will change you if you allow him to, if you'll receive his grace and mercy. So what happens if I ask God when I mess up for his grace and mercy? Well, he does 2 things. He forgives me and he frees me. Forgiveness takes care of my past guilt, and freedom gives me the power to be able to change in the future. I'm forgiven from my past, so that means I can pursue the future that God has for me. So many people, they are they're locked into their past. They can't get over their past. I want to tell you, that is not God's will for us. God wants to forgive you and set you free. This is the very thing that Jesus came to do. In Isaiah 61:1, Jesus actually quotes the scripture. It says, "He has sent me to comfort the brokenhearted and to proclaim that captives will be released and prisoners will be free." I'm going to read that again. "He has sent me to comfort the brokenhearted and to proclaim that captives will be released and prisoners will be free." He's not just talking about that prisoners, like in physical prisoner in prison. He's talking about emotional prison. He's talking about self-inflicted bondages, whether it's envy or strife or bitterness. We have a very powerful skit to really illustrate this point.
Captive free, Jesus rest.
powerful skit. You know, Jesus came, died, rose again to set the captives free. And my question to you today is, what holds you captive? What has gotten you chained up inside? What's enslaved you? For some of you in a crowd this size, maybe it's regret. Maybe there's something that you cannot forgive yourself from. Maybe something you did years ago, and you just have not been able to bring yourself to receive the forgiveness that you need. Maybe some of you, it's resentment. Somebody's done something to you, and you haven't been able to forgive that person. And I heard something years ago that just always stuck with me. When we have bitterness, when we have unforgiveness, it's like drinking poison and expecting the other person to die. Maybe for some people, maybe there's a prison of envy. You're just kind of like, you're in that comparison game. Man, I wish my husband was like that person's husband. Or I wish my wife was like that person's wife. Or I wish my family was like that family. Or I wish I had a career like he has or she has. Some of you, maybe it's a prison of worry. You're just always worried. You're just sick. You're just sick just from worrying so much. Maybe for others, it's an addiction or a secret sin or a habit. Well, what does Jesus have to say about this? Well, John 12:47, Jesus said, I have come to save the world and not to judge it. I love that. I've come to save the world and not judge it. My job as pastors is not to judge the world. My job is to point people to the Savior, to point people to Jesus. Because there's only one Savior, and certainly not me. It's not you. It's not that person sitting next to you. It's Jesus and it's Jesus only. And let me be clear, there's going to be a judgment day, no doubt about it. The Bible is very clear about this, that at the end of time, every single person is going to have to give an account of their life. They're going to have to stand before God on judgment day. But that day is only for people who rejected the grace and mercy of God. God doesn't want to judge you. He wants to show you grace and mercy. It's why Jesus came to earth. That's why he offers us grace and mercy. It's his nature. He's a merciful God. And the only people that are going to be judged on judgment day is going to be the people that reject the grace and mercy of God. James 2:13 says this, great verse, mercy triumphs over judgment. I'll say that again, mercy triumphs over judgment. I'm glad for this verse. It means that I'm not going to get what I deserve. You're not going to get what you deserve if we will accept the grace and the mercy of God. And I want to give you three things that we need to do to be able to experience the forgiveness of God and grace of God. And I'm going to ask us to remain in our seat and no moving around right now. This is very important. We only have just a few minutes. I want to give you three things here. First thing is we need to be honest with God. When Jesus spoke to the woman that was caught up in adultery, she didn't deny it. She agreed with Jesus. And if you want to be clean, you've got to come clean with God. We need to admit, God, we've messed up. God, we've sinned. And that's hard for us. Why? Because our human nature is to defend our action. It's to justify our behavior. And here's what Proverbs 28:13 says. He who conceals his sin does not prosper, but whoever confesses and renounces them finds mercy. I want to read that again. He who conceals his sin does not prosper, but whoever confesses and renounces them finds mercy. When you confess your sin, I want to tell you, you're not telling God anything that he doesn't already know. It's not like you're saying, hey, God, you know, when I got in that little thing with that person yesterday at work, I hated that person in my heart. Or when that person, you know, cut me off in traffic, man, I wanted to pull that guy out of the car and deck him. You know what? You're not telling him. You know, when you say that, God's not up there. Oh, my gosh, I can't believe that you actually thought that. I didn't believe that that was in your heart. I want to tell you, God knows everything. He knows everything. The Bible says he knows our prayers before we even ask. He knows our thoughts before we even think them. He knows everything that we've done wrong. He has every hair on our head counted. So when we admit to God, God, we've blown it. God, please forgive me. God, I ask you to forgive me for my sin. God forgives you. And when you confess your sin and you admit it, that unleashes, that really allows God's grace and mercy to fill you and allows you to change. So we need to admit it. We need to be honest with God. Number two, we need to get a new heart. When people mess up, they usually beg for a second chance. And you've probably heard, you know, God's a God of a second chance. I've said that before, and it's true, but we need to drill deeper. When we ask for a second chance, and we'll find, hey, well, we need a third chance and a fourth chance, where does it end? The woman in the story didn't need a second chance. She needed a new life. And God wants to give you something more than just a second chance. He wants to give you a changed heart. He wants to give you a new heart. And you'll never experience the fullness of God's grace until you understand that. You don't need a second chance. You need a new heart. That's what repentance means. Repentance is a change of mind that leads to a change of behavior. So in order for us to experience the grace, the mercy of God, we need to be honest with God, and then we need to get a new heart. Here's number three. Forgive yourself and move forward. Once you've confessed and repented of your sin, then you must receive and accept God's forgiveness. You must believe that God has completely forgiven you. God makes many promises through his word from the beginning to the end. He gives us all kinds of assurances of his forgiveness. So I just want to read a couple. Isaiah 1:18 says, though your sins are like scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they are red as crimson, they shall be like wool. Psalms 103:12 says, as far as the east is from the west, so far has he removed our transgressions from us. God really can forgive and forget. Our trouble is that we can't forget. And once you've accepted God's forgiveness, sometimes the hardest part is to be able to forgive ourselves. And you know, the devil can't prevent God's forgiveness from happening. But what he can do is he can come to us and he can try to get us to doubt, to get us to question whether or not we feel forgiven. That's why the Bible in Revelations describes the devil as the accuser of the brethren. Even when you confess your sin and you repent of your sin, the devil wants you to feel dirty. He's going to come, he's going to whisper in your ear that, man, who do you think you are? Do you really think God's going to forgive you again? Man, you have used your last get out of jail free card. It's up, dude. You are a loser. That is why it's so important that we come together like this on a regular basis and be reminded in a service like this of God's great love for us, of his grace, and actually the plan that he has for every single one of us here today. I want to encourage you to come back next week and hear more about the grace of God. But the good news of Easter is this: regardless of where you've been or what you have done, God's love and God's grace is available to you. Jesus came to bring freedom, grace, and forgiveness. He's the Christ who saves you from sin and fills you with his joy. And then he commissions us to go out and pass that same message on to people around us that haven't received Christ. Let's just bow our heads and pray right now.